and all the time. He sure is. He sure is. There's nobody like him. Nobody. I just welcome you here today. I just thank the Lord for always keeping open door for what he does here in the midst of us. And it might look like there's not many in here today. Don't know why. Don't know why. But the one thing that amazes me is that God is always faithful and that he always takes care of us. He always takes care of us. And he continues to keep the door open. And I'm so grateful because it's people like you and it's folks like those that are on the live stream that watch and glean from the house. And when you take in and you receive, it's always a good thing to give because we're all blessed to be a blessing. So as you prepare your hearts this morning, I'm going to ask our ushers if they will come and get ready this morning to receive our tithe and our offering today. Go ahead and stand with me if you would, and we're going to bless the Lord this morning and give of our offering this morning. But he says he wants us to be a cheerful giver. You know, all that you have belongs to him. All that we are belongs to him. Amen? All that we are. Because we're nothing without him. We can't do anything without him. If you're totally, totally relying on him, you cannot make it without him. And I wouldn't want to try. I wouldn't want to live a day without him because he is truly, truly my Father. And I trust in him. But I'm just so excited about what he does in our lives every day. And we're believing that the area, our economy is blessed. We don't speak negative over this area. We just speak that the Lord is bringing good jobs with good salaries and benefits into this area. We're prosperous. We're blessed. We're going forward in this area. And we're not going to speak darkness, but we speak the light. And you know who the light is? It's Jesus. So he's revealing himself. He's revealing himself all around. But I speak over you that you're blessed and highly favored, and that you have favor on your jobs, that you have increase. And it comes from every direction because it's out there and it belongs to you. And there's nothing like getting a check. We got a check last week and wasn't expecting it. And it came, you know, my husband, you know, my mother-in-law passed about a month ago. And we had already taken care of things, and we have gotten two checks back from the funeral home already because we don't know, except for it's the, you know, the blessing of the Lord, because we had, you know, everything had already been taken care of. And even when we went to make some last-minute decisions on some things, picking some things out that had already been paid for, the prices on the things in there had gone up amazingly since we had went and paid for the things. So they sent two checks back. We got one back a couple weeks ago and one back last week. So, I mean, you know, you never know where it's going to come from, you know. So you just, you, when you walk believing that you are blessed of the Lord, it can come from any direction. It can come back from the power company where it needs to come back from because I think they charge what they want to charge. They put some new meters over there in our neighborhood, and it's like things have just went boom. I'm like, wait a minute. Something's going on here. And but, you know, we don't need to worry or fret. We just need to rest in him because we know that he's always going to take care of us. Amen. And if you're looking for a new job, or you're looking for a job, or you're looking for a promotion, expect it. Expect it. Pray, believe, and expect the Lord to bless you. Okay? Because he said he would. Amen. You got to believe it for it to work. And I know that it can work. So I thank the Lord for that. And for those of you that have been praying for my brother, I want to testify before we go. I shared this in a Wednesday night, but my brother, I've been praying for my brother for a very long time. And I'm the oldest of the siblings. And so my brother is the middle. And for those of you that do know, my father, he died. He was an alcoholic. He died with cirrhosis of the liver. And 7 years ago. And my brother is in his 40s, and he was following the same track as my dad. And we really didn't have a relationship because he never wanted to really talk to me. Or, you know, I don't know if it was guilt or shame that caused him to isolate himself, but he didn't really want to be around. And he had hurt his back at the end of December, first of January, and was taken to the emergency room because he's a roofer. And in that process, he found out that he had hepatitis C. And for the last months and months, he was going to specialists. They sent him to a liver specialist and things, and they said, if you have cirrhosis of the liver, you will not get treatment. The insurance company will not provide it. If you have any pre-existing conditions going on in your body, they will not give you the okay to get the medicine. You will be denied. He was denied 3 times. He went back. The specialist said, you have no cirrhosis of the liver. So then the insurance company granted the medications. Well, it's 3 rounds of medication, and it's $25,000 for each one. So there is a percentage coming out of your pocket also. Well, anyway, to make a long story short, when my brother went to the hospital then, my brother has been sober. He hasn't touched anything. And let me tell you, my brother liked to drink every day. And he liked to smoke him a little weed every day. And that was his normal routine. He has been so clean. And he called me Monday morning. No, the doctors called him Monday morning. He called me Wednesday morning, and he said, Teresa, because our relationship has been turned around, and we are so close and communicating, and just, you know, it's been awesome. But he said, I went, got another, you know, before each one round of medicine, they have to do a full panel of blood work and everything. Well, they called him Monday morning and said, you have no hepatitis in your body. And he just now is finishing up the first round of medicine. And I know that it was God. So I just thank the Lord that my brother is healed and delivered and set free. And just like the song we sang, the chains are being broken off. If you're standing and believing for your family's salvation, you keep on praying, because the Lord hears your prayers. If you're believing for healing in your body, God hears your prayers, because he says that by his stripes we are the healed of the Lord. So we just need to trust and believe in him. So I'm just saying that because, you know, you need to latch on to the testimonies that you hear, because God can duplicate, you know. So I know there's somebody out there watching that needed to hear that. And we just declare that we are the healed of the Lord, and we're blessed and highly favored. Father, in the name of Jesus right now, I ask, Lord God, that you bless this tithe and offering, that you use it to keep the kingdom of God going forward. And I thank you that these doors will remain open. And as you, Father, speak from this house, we just thank you that you take care of our needs, and we're going to trust and believe in you. We thank you for the live stream, those that feed, that are all over the country. Lord, we just thank you, Father God, that they take hold of the word that they're hearing, and that it makes a difference in their life. And I thank you for the seed that they sow into this house, Lord. We bless you, we honor you, and thank you, Lord God, that we're blessed and highly favored, and we're going forward in you. In the name of Jesus, and we all sit together, amen. Amen. Bless the Lord in your tithe and giving this morning, and find somebody and love on them real quick.
in the streets. Jesus is alive. All creation shouts now. Jesus is alive. Now surely we can all be changed. Cause Jesus is alive. And everybody here can know Jesus is alive. Well, I will live through all my days to raise the banner of truth and light. And sing about my Savior's love. And the best thing that happened was the day I met you.
There's a song I want you to learn. And when you come back to my church, I want you to sing it.
If it had not been for the Lord on my side, tell me.
All right. Y'all can go ahead and be seated. Richard. Praise God. Some of us have to multitask around here, so you have to. First of all, I want to say good morning, and it's so good to have y'all in the house of the Lord today. Our announcements. Tuesday night is prayer at 6:30. Our midweek service is at 6:30. We have a great time coming into the fellowship hall and just sitting around the tables and sharing and talking. And Pastor has been teaching a great word, so come on out and be a part of that. Today at 3 o'clock is the next session on the Financial University with Dave Ramsey, so please come out and be a part of that. Also today at 5 p.m. is education training, hospitality, and anyone who wants to serve during the conference with Miss Bev. Okay? So if you serve in hospitality here or you teach, please come on out and be a part of that if you want to be a part of something like that. If you're interested, if you just want to come and sit and be in it, come on out. Okay? Elders meeting, September the 28th at 7 p.m. That's Thursday. October the 15th, we're having a hot dog heaven lunch. Okay. This is a fundraiser by the teens for their shoebox goals. They have reached the goal of their 40 boxes. So please bring in the things to fill the boxes and fund the shipping. And you know, every year we do this, and the teen class has taken it upon themselves to do the boxes. It's the Samaritan's Purse, and that's in Charlotte. They go, we have been up there to take part in that. But those boxes go all over the world to kids all over. And if you have a question about what needs to go in the box, we're going to be getting a list. And, you know, toothbrush, toothpaste, combs, socks, toys, pencils, paper, you name it, it goes in there, except for liquid. Liquid stuff does not go in there. And I don't think chocolate goes in there. No chocolate. No Tootsie Rolls. They're chocolate. Okay. That's a shame, because Tootsie Rolls are so good. But, you know, there's a lot of things that can go in that box. And it is a blessing to those children when they get them. So their teens are working on that, and that's what they're going to be doing with this hot dog thing. Okay? Everybody loves a good hot dog. I think it's hot dog, coleslaw, potato salad, baked beans, and, you know, you drink and chips or whatever, and a piece of cake, I think, too. Anyway, it's going to be good, so please, we're going to be doing that, okay? Our work day is Saturday, October the 21st. We always have a great time. We do one in the spring, and then we do one in the fall, and we come at 9 o'clock on Saturday morning, and we do cleaning from the inside out, getting ready for our conference. And conference is at the end of the month, and it's the 28th, 29th, and 30th, and we always have a wonderful time. We have guests that come in from all around, and we just want our house looking nice and clean and pretty, right? You clean your house up, don't you? Especially if you know somebody's coming, you're going to clean it up and tidy it up. So that's what we're going to do. But we always have a good time when we clean. We have a lot of fun and fellowship together, and that's because we're family. Amen. Is that it, Sandra? Our focus family is Patricia. Patricia, David, and O'Neill. Amen. Blessed of the Lord. Amen. I think Patricia is phenomenal. She's amazing. And her boys are too. So praise God. Well, that's it. Pastor is not here this morning. He is in Virginia. And he's ministering there last night and this morning, and he'll be coming back in today. So just keep him in your prayers. But we are going to be blessed with Brother Joey this morning. So I'm going to ask you to stand one more time. We're going to pray for our young people so that they can go to their classes. And then we're going to just open up Brother Joey. Father, I thank you for all of our children in this house, our teenagers, our young people. I thank you for those that serve in the house and minister to them, Father. I ask that you just pour into them as they pour out to our youth. And I thank you for the seed that's being planted and sown in them, Lord. And we thank you, Father, that they will grow and mature in the Lord. And we just thank you for phenomenal kids in this house. Lord, I thank you for each and every one that's here today. And for Brother Joey, Lord, as he comes and shares his heart, Lord, I thank you that we just receive him and the Christ that's in him. And Lord, we just thank you for everything that's said and done today. And for I thank you for everyone that's here. And for our pastor, we ask that you keep him, watch over him, and bless him. And we thank you for all of those, Lord God, that are watching on live stream. We just speak blessing over them, Father. And we just give you thanks for this day that you've made. And we are glad to be here in the house of the Lord today. And in agreement we said, amen. Amen. I bless you. You may be seated. Young people, you can go to your class. I'm going to give this to you.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. You can probably turn that down a little bit. My mouth is big. We discussed using pastor's mic, but we decided it was not a good plan. Might just mess him up. Bless these folks who take these young people and minister to them. My wife and I have been in active children's ministry for nearly 20 years, and it's a job. It's a job to take these kids and wrangle them. My wife used to say it's like trying to herd hummingbirds. Can you imagine herding hummingbirds? that's what you're trying to do with kids. And so we are we're certainly thankful for those folks who take their time. It's a lot of work, a lot of hard work goes into ministering to kids, but they're the next generation. They're who's coming up. We got to teach them. Praise God. I'm glad she stopped talking about food, because I've got to talk for a few minutes here, and if she reminded you all of how hungry you were, you might decide you want me to be a little shorter. Somebody told me they need to leave at noon. They wouldn't hear my whole message, and I said, well, that's not necessarily true. If Pastor John was here, you may not hear his whole message, but you will very likely hear all of mine. Praise God, praise God. He called me on Friday and pitched me right into the deep end. I thought he was inviting me over to the house for something to eat, or, you know, maybe to go out for a steak. He said, I'm leaving and you're preaching. I said, all right, okay, that's the way you're going to be. We'll do it. Praise God. He gave me an assignment. And part of that assignment is one of the things that drew me to this house. I've not been drawn to this house, folks, because we got a big crowd here. Now, by the Spirit, every seat in this place is filled. But I was not drawn here because there were crowds here. I was drawn here by the message, by the gospel that is preached here. And one of the things that I noticed very first off is that your pastor always blesses you. Now, I've been going to church. I've been drugged to church since I was about 3 days old. Okay, I mean, people tell stories of my mother dancing in the aisles and all around my head, and I was underneath the pew. And so I've been around a while, long enough to know that it's a rare thing to have a pastor get up and bless the people the way your pastor blesses you. And he said, you know how I do this? He said, I want you to bless the people. I want you to edify them. So open door. You're blessed and highly favored. You're the healed of God. You're blessed with every spiritual gift in the heavenly Christ. Jesus was crucified, died, and he was buried. He was quickened, raised, and seated for you. And guess what? So were you. All of those things that he did them for you. You're doing better than your circumstance. You're doing better than how things look, open door. Oh, there may only be 20 people in here, but we're doing better than how things look. Praise God. Just blesses you, and he can go on and on and on and on and on. And we won't go any further than that, but we know that he can go on. And he just, it's amazing to me the stuff that he pulls out and blesses us with. And that's one of the things that drew me to this work, because it's just something that I had not experienced before, a lot of pastors want to be blessed. I'm not trying to meddle this morning, but a lot of pastors want to be blessed, but not a lot of them want to bless. Come on now. We've all been around the fence a time or two. We know how this works. And so then he said to me, he said, I want you to tell them what you've learned. My, what have I learned? I mean, I've learned a lot of stuff. So I thought, well, I'll start with this. Tell them what you've learned. Well, one of the things that Pastor John has taught me is on the subject of marriage, that no man can serve two masters. That's one of the things that he taught me. And that Deuteronomy is Mitt Romney's brother. And probably plausible way we're going to beat the Baptist to the steakhouse. That's his thing. We're not going to beat the Baptist to the steakhouse today, and we're probably not going to beat them there today on my account either. Praise God. I tell you what, I was reading through some scripture, I found 2 Corinthians 4:1-7 says, as we have received mercy, we faint not. We have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, and whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of this glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves. And I thought, there is a scripture, and I want to give honor to the pastor this morning, because that's a scripture I believe that describes him. He doesn't handle the word of God deceitfully or craftily. He just tells you what it says. The gospel is preached here, and you are blessed because it is. And I have been blessed. My wife and I have been forever changed, forever altered. And he says all the time that if you get a hold of this thing, you need to understand that it will alter who you are. You'll forever be changed, and you can't go back. You can't go back. Once you've heard the gospel, you can't go back. So my assignment this morning, I'm going to throw some stuff out here. I wonder if we can do 45 Pastor John sermons in 45 minutes. You think we could do that? Praise God. The Bible is a perfect book. The first time he said that, I knew it was true. But then he begins to unfold things of how the Bible is a perfect book. There's just some of it we don't understand. That's okay, isn't it? It's okay that you don't understand everything, that you don't know everything, but it doesn't make it less than a perfect book. I can tread on scorpions and snakes. I thought, what in the world is he talking about? Whether it has a bite from its mouth or it stings from its tail, whether it comes from the beginning or it comes in the end, it can't hurt me because I can tread on scorpions and snakes. I'm not cursed. Brother Mike, I'm not cursed. Do you know how long I've been cursed in church? Praise God, I've been cursed in church. You don't pay your tithe, you're cursed. That's not what it says. Not to me. I'm living in a new covenant. I'm blessed to give. I'm not cursed. I tell you what, that delivered me. I shouted when I found out I wasn't cursed. And see, I've been ministering the gospel for long enough that I felt like sometimes I hear these things and I'm thinking, I should have known this. I feel like I've gone to school. I feel like I've been to college. You're learning things that you should have known. They're right there. They're right there. God's not mad. God's not mad. I said, are you kidding me? Of course he's mad, because I'm mad. God's not mad at you. He's not angry. Everything that he was angry about, he put on Jesus. And he killed you on that cross. That was, man, oh day. That was when I realized that I died on that cross. I died up there. I've never heard this before. Isaiah 53, everything was laid on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. God's not mad at me anymore. And so then I had a decision to make. Am I going to keep being mad? Because he tells us, you know, we can't preach good news mad. I'll tell you what, I think over some messages that I've preached to people, and I have to question myself how much it was actually good news. It's hard. It's hard when you get re-educated to understand what you've been speaking and saying most of your adult life is not the gospel. You can preach the Bible and not preach the gospel, but you can't preach the gospel without preaching the Bible. What have I learned? I'm an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus. Romans 8:17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so, we suffer with him that we may be also glorified together. I'm an heir of God. I'm rich. Do you know you're rich today? Oh, rich ain't about what's in your pocket. It ain't about what's in your pocket. I'm rich today. There are 39 verses in the book of Romans chapter 8. There are 39 verses. They all correlate to the 39 books of the Old Testament. It's a perfect book. I've never heard anybody preach that kind of stuff. 39 verses, 39 books. Jesus was crucified. He died. He was buried. He was quickened, raised, and seated, and so was I. Jesus was not made sin. I nearly come out of my seat yesterday when I wrote this down. Jesus was not made sin by works, so I can't be made righteous by works. Whew! I have worked hard in ministry. I could tell you some stories. I have sweated. I have done stuff that I thought was completely ridiculous. And now I understand that it is. It was ridiculous. I have been asked to do things and thought, that doesn't make any sense. But you do it because you're trying to be obedient, trying to be under authority. All these words and phrases that we attach to it. But the truth of the matter is, it is ridiculous, some of the things that we try to do to be saved. Jesus was not made sin by works, so I can't be made righteous by works. Romans 5:19, for as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Jesus wasn't human. That one took me 3 weeks. 3 weeks. I was like, okay. Now you just about pushed me right over the cliff there. Now, I had to wrap my head around it. I mean, I've read some books and I've been through some theology and I've listened to a lot of things and I thought, I ain't ever heard. What do you mean Jesus wasn't human? But as he unfolded that he was a man like as Adam was before the fall. That's why we call him the second Adam. It's simple. It's in the scripture. It's right there in front of me, Mike. Praise God. What have I learned? Whew. And it just went on and on and on. Adam's journey began in the garden. Jesus' journey ended in one. It's a perfect book. It's a perfect book. He was separated so that I could be joined. What God worked in Christ was greater than what Satan worked in Adam. The greater one lives in me. The greater one lives in you. I mean, he was talking one time about a conference that he went to. People said, hey, what's the strongest spirit in this community? He went around the room, all these preachers. You know, this spirit and that spirit and the other spirit. And they got to him and he said, the Holy Ghost is the strongest spirit in this community. I have sat and had those conversations. There's a spirit of depression in this community. There's a spirit of... I got a mess in my mouth. We used to ride through Cumberland, Maryland. Place looks like Gotham City. If you ever seen the Batman movies, it looks like Gotham City. There's a spirit of oppression on this city. It's still, the Holy Ghost is still the most powerful spirit there. Wow! It seems so simple now when you hear yourself say, you think, man, what's some dumb stuff that I used to say? Whew. He arose out of everything that was mine and gave me everything that was his. Pastor John calls that the great exchange. The great exchange. And I got the better end of the deal. We had a conversation about some folks that we got folks that are preaching social justice. Mike, we had some conversation about this. There is no social justice in Jesus, Mike. Because he did some stuff for you that don't make no sense. I'm glad he did some... He fixed... Do you realize it's like I did something that was dumb And now he's my lawyer and the judge. I'm going to get off. How can you? You've got the whole thing fixed. It's like being in the mob. Praise God. I'm healed because he took stripes on his back. The veil that was ripped. See, this when we begin talking about the veil that was ripped, I was always taught, and it was always preached to me, that veil was ripped so that I had access. So I got to go in. But the veil was ripped so he could get out, and he ain't never going back. It ripped when he left. And he left because he wants to live in you. I'm just telling you that some of this stuff is so simple, but it just rocked me. I have the promise of Abraham on me. This is just persistent theme, because Abraham was not made righteous through the works of the law. I have the blessing of Abraham on me. Now, I said this to my mother. I said, you know, you have the blessings of Abraham on you. And she said, I do. And I said, yes. I said, you know, Sarah was old and hadn't had a child, and you know, she got to live another 36 years. I said, but she did have babies. And she said, I don't want the blessings of Abraham. It's your choice. You don't have to take it. It's your choice. I can lift up holy hands, one without fear and one without doubt. I can't tell you how many times I've stood and somebody said, lift up holy hands, and I'm thinking, okay. I can't do that, but I can. I can lift up holy hands, one without fear and one without doubt. Jesus wants me to be at rest. The church doesn't necessarily want me to be at rest, but Jesus wants me to be at rest. Hey, and I'm at rest in him. No matter what happens, I am at rest in him. The earth is groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God. You can look around. I shared this with Pastor. I've heard so many folks, you know, these hurricanes and the things that we've got going on, and it's judgment, 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 judgment. And I'm thinking, really? God's judging the sons and daughters of the Most High God in Florida. Sons and daughters of the Most High God in Texas are being judged. Creation's groaning. I've got the same things that he's got. He stood up in the boat and said, peace be still. It is his desire that you and I walk there. That's what we're growing into. That's what we're growing up into. I don't have to fear what's coming, because Jesus is the beginning and he's the end. The seventh angel sounded when Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach good news. Man undid my eschatology. I went down, I had some questions. I said, you got to tell me, you got to explain to me, what's your eschatology, Pastor? Three words. Behold, he comes. I said, well, what are we going to talk about now? Behold, he comes. Get so confused. He described it to me, and when he talked to me on Friday, as somebody putting a bag over your head and putting you in a dark room and saying, look, don't you see it? That's how we preach what's coming. I've been freed from so much fear. I just... The mystery revealed is Christ in you. The little book that John 8 was the new covenant. And you all hear this stuff all the time, and I know you're saying, oh man, we've heard him say. But man, this stuff revolutionized who I was in Christ. It freed me. It delivered me from things. It changed me. I'm not under the law. I'm not under the law. Whoo! Romans 7:4 tells me I'm not under the law. Christianity is not a fight. It's not a funeral. It's not a famine. It's a feast. It's a feast. We're feasting. We've been feasting for 2,000 years. Yesterday was a big day, Mike. Big day. We're still here. We're still here. Because somebody's got messed up in time. And the church is being moved to truth. Jesus will come when there's truth. He'll come when there's truth. There's truth. It's beginning to be taught. It's beginning to be heard. People are receiving it. People are hearing it. And I'm telling you, God is on the move. Praise God. Mark 10, 17. If you want to turn there with me, I'm going to deviate from my assignment and talk to you for just a couple of minutes here on a subject the Lord laid on my heart about 3 or 4 weeks ago. Mark chapter 10, verse 17. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments: do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother." And he answered and said unto him, "Master, all these things have I observed from my youth." Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, "One thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross, follow me." And he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked round about and said to his disciples, "How hardly shall they that have riches enter the kingdom of God?" And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answers again and saith unto them, "Children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And they were astonished out of measure, saying to themselves, "Who then can be saved?" Who then can be saved? My journey as a Christian began when I was 7 years old. I was out playing. I was riding my bicycle. And some boys began to poke fun at me because I had training wheels on my bike. And I came in the house and I was upset. And I came into the house to my grandfather, who was a man of great prayer. I mean, he prayed like Daniel prayed. I mean, he was routine about it. 8:30 at night, he would stand up. It didn't matter what kind of party you were having, what kind of going on, if he hadn't seen you in 20 years. He stood up at 8:30 and he said, "Good night. I'm going to bed." And he would go in and he would pray 30 minutes. And then he would lie down at 9 o'clock. And when he got up out of bed in the morning, he would pray for 30 minutes. And he ate a bologna sandwich on toasted bread every day. Every day. He drank only coffee, cold or hot. He was a Cherokee Indian. And he was a man of just routine. And I came in that day and I was angry. I wanted to beat somebody up. He said, "That's not what we do." He said, "We're going to get down and we're going to talk to God about this." So I knelt down with him, and he just began to pray over me and over the situation, and he blessed those young men, and he forgave those young men. And the more he prayed, the more the Spirit began to move upon me. And at 7 years old, I received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues at my grandfather's couch. That's where my journey began. And I was pure, and I was excited. Went back to my home church in Marion, Indiana, and I was baptized. Things were good when you're seven. I began to preach when I was 12. Preached in Sunday school class. And it wasn't long into my preaching that I encountered what Pastor John describes as some religious people. Folks who wanted to explain to me why it was that what I was preaching was not so. And sometimes you need to be corrected in love. And it just rocked me. I was just like, if this is what I have to be to serve God, I just don't know that I'm interested. And it took me 17 years to answer the call that God had placed on my life to preach the Word. 17 years. I was 29 when I finally completed all of the requirements to become a minister in the organization that I was licensed through, and I'll not name them because we're streaming live. But it was an organization very similar to Pastor John's background. You know, you had to do a lot of stuff. You had to pile your hair up on your head just so. Your skirt had to be long enough. It really doesn't have anything to do with me, Mike, does it? Seems like it's we got to control these women. They're out of control. But all these rules and all these regulations, and I did them. I adhered to them. Out of obedience, I did what they asked me to do. I didn't have a television in my home. We weren't even allowed to wear t-shirts that had stuff printed on them. Mike's got some of them stories he can tell you. But I did them. I did them because I thought that's what I needed to do to be a part of what I was a part of. I'm glad when I found Open Door, I found out that y'all aren't religious people. You're just people that love Jesus. And at every turn, I kept coming back to this place where I thought, man, I'm here again. Again, I'm encountering these folks. I've followed their rules, and here I am again. I've followed this set of rules, and here I am again. And I got to this spot where I said, Lord, I'm just not going to do this anymore. I'm not going to play this game. You're going to have to show me something because this is not working for me. I'm doing it the way they say I'm supposed to do it. And here I am again. And then I found Open Door and I began to hear the gospel. And the other day as I was reading through this scripture, I just was drawn to some things, and the Lord showed me some stuff yesterday as I was reading it again. First of all, it says when Jesus was gone forth into the way, you see, he was headed somewhere. We read the gospel sometimes, we think Jesus just wandered around and just did the stuff that he did, but he was headed somewhere. He was on a specific path. He was in the way. And there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, Good master, what shall I do? Boy, I've been there before. What do I got to do to inherit eternal life? Well, you got to pay your tithe. You got to have perfect attendance. You gotta. You see, I believe that this young man that came running to him in the way, he had probably already encountered some religious people. He'd already found some folks who told him, listen, you know, the same thing that Jesus is about to tell him, what he had to do to be saved. And so he came to Jesus and he said, what do I got to do? And Jesus said, well, you know the commandments. He quoted 6 to him. You know the commandments. And he said, all these have I done from my youth. I've already done this, Jesus. I've been around this this mountain more than once. I've followed all the rules and the regulations over there, and I followed all the rules and the regulations over here, and I'm coming to you and I'm saying to you, I've already done that. What grabbed me in this scripture was that Jesus beheld him. And when you look up that word beheld, and you begin to flesh it out a little bit, you find out that Jesus intently gazed at him. When he said to Jesus, I've done that, he got Jesus' attention. And Jesus, beholding him, loved him. See, that's what we need. We don't need somebody to tell us the rules again. We need somebody to love us. Jesus, beholding him, loved him. And Jesus did something to him, and I have inserted myself into this story. Because even though I had a grasp of what I thought was going on here, when Pastor was talking about the six views of the cross, he began to speak about how it is that when you look in context to those places where Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me, what he's really doing is he is disqualifying the person. Do you know how many people in my life have disqualified me? And I've spent a lot of my life and a lot of my time in hatred and anger at them for disqualifying me. But see, Jesus quoted the law to him because the law is designed to be the schoolmaster that leads you to Christ. You've got to get disqualified before you realize that you need something beyond the law. All these people, when I was 12, I was disqualified. When I was 17, I was disqualified. I couldn't wear jeans and play the drums. Every time I turned around, someone was disqualifying me from what I needed. And they were doing me a favor. I didn't see it as a favor then, but I see it as a favor now. Because see, every time that you get disqualified, it keeps pushing you back to Christ. Keeps pushing you back to Jesus. Because He's the only place that you're ever going to find your deliverance. You're not going to find it in the rules. You're not going to find it in the regulations. You're not going to find it in the do this and the do that. You're going to find it when you realize that you cannot do it yourself. The question he asks is, what must I do to be saved? There's only one answer. There's nothing you can do to save you. You can put up Galatians 2:16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. It's simple. All along the path, people were disqualifying me, trying to They were being used to do something they didn't even know they were doing. Because I got news for you. All things work together for my good. Joseph said what they meant for evil, God meant it for good. There were some folks who meant some things for evil, but God turned it around and He turned that disqualification into something that was going to point me back to Him, and that's where I found my deliverance in Jesus. I want to warn you. I want to admonish you that when you meet somebody who says, "I'm saved," whoo, don't stop there. Because there's some saved folks need delivered. I needed delivered. Because I was angry that I was disqualified. And what I needed to do was shout. I need to shout that somebody disqualified me. Pushed me in the direction that I needed to go. To find the Jesus that was always there. Was always there. He was embracing me, I just wasn't embracing Him. It's just that simple. It's just that easy. I don't have to hate my mother. I don't have to hate my father. He said that to them as well. You see, what He did this, when he, come take up your cross and follow me. You got to hate your mother, you got to hate your father. Pastor John stood up here and he said, I don't hate my mother. I'm disqualified. They want to throw the portion of the law at you that they keep. I keep this part, so I'm going to throw it at you. And I've been angry with those folks. And I think in the last 3 days, as I begin to just read this again and again and again, I begin to just let go of that. You can't preach good news mad. You got to get happy. You got to forgive folks. Those folks were doing what they thought was best. They were sincere. They were sincerely wrong, but they were sincere. You got to start somewhere. You got to love them where they are. We seem to be able to love people that don't know anything about Jesus pretty well right where they are. Whew, it's a bigger challenge to love religious people. That's what we've got to do. Would you stand with me this morning? I cannot tell you. I can't give you the depth of. And I said this once before here that I feel like maybe I've only been saved about a year and a half, and I know that sounds odd, but you get to that place where you live it. Again, these stories Pastor John talks about, wondering where mom and dad were and thinking maybe he'd missed the rapture. I grew up there. I grew up living in that fear. I was eternally insecure. Eternally insecure. And now I know. It ain't about me. It ain't about me. He bought property and he's not going to sell it. Isn't that awesome? When you put it back on him where it belongs, you can rest there. There's rest. There's rest. Let's pray. Lord, we just worship you for rest. Lord, we're thankful for rest today. God, that you did it, Lord. All of these things that have to do with salvation and all of them, almost every one of them, Lord, outside of our simple belief in what you did, God, you made it so easy even a child could understand it. Lord, I thank you for delivering me from this anger, this hatred, this frustration. God, now there are folks that I could not minister to that because you have showed me this, because you have showed us this, we can reach folks we couldn't reach before. Lord, we thank you today. We worship you today. We honor you today. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, let it grow and take root. Lord, good seed on good ground. Lord, we thank you today that we've learned, that we've grown. Lord, we worship you. We honor your name in Jesus' name. Everybody shout out real loud, amen. 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 Do you want to have the elders come, or you come and go ahead and have the elders come, and I'll turn this back over to Pastor Teresa. Lord bless you.
Amen. Thank you, brother. We are richly blessed to be connected with Joey and Kesia. We thank God for you. Well, praise God. As you go this week, may you have a wonderful week, a blessed week. Remember all the different things that are going on. Financial class at 3. Education hospitality meeting at 4. No, 5, excuse me. And we have prayer Tuesday night. Wednesday night we have class. So go this week knowing that you are blessed, 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 and highly favored of the Lord, and that you're blessed to be a blessing to those that you come in contact with. So let the light of Jesus shine forth and radiate His love to those that you talk to through this week. Amen. Remember that this altar is open. If you need prayer for anything, we're here as elders to pray with you. And so we just bless you and just thank God for you. Amen. Father, we just thank you for this day, for this opportunity that we've had to hear your word. Lord, we just thank you for each and every one for bringing us together this day. We ask, Lord, as we go, that we are blessed to be a blessing to those that we come in contact with. We are light that can be seen and salt that can be tasted. We're making a difference in our community, Lord, and in our families, in the jobs, in the schools. We're making a difference. And we thank you, Father God, that you love us unconditionally, and may we radiate that unconditional love to those around us. We love you, Father. We just thank you for this day, for your protection, for your guidance, and just watching over us and keeping us throughout this week. We honor you, and we give you all praise. And together we said, amen. I bless you in Jesus' name.